remarkable idea if you stop to think about it. Very.
I don't see what this has to do with
it. Now, suppose that one microparasite learned through long evolutionary processes to stimulate regrowth in the animal tissue they devoured. Quite an advancement, huh?
Go on.
But it's only a first step. It lets the host live longer, though not pleasantly, I imagine. The growth control would be clumsy at first. Soon, though, all parasite species either learned to do it or died out.
Makes sense.
Now, the parasite which kept its host in the best physical condition had a better chance of survival. Scientific farming, you might say. Horns, claws, fangs, stingers, poison throwers, we can only guess. Eventually, one group of parasites hit upon what? Say it.
The nervous system.
That's right. The nervous system. It was probably an unsuccessful parasite at first, because nerve tissue grows very slowly. And it's a long stretch of evolution between a microspecies which could stimulate nerve growth and one which could direct and utilize that growth to the host's advantage and for its own. But at last, after a long struggle, our little species gets there. It begins sharpening its host senses, building up complex senses from less developed receptors, and finally increasing the host's intelligence within limits.
But how?
Such parasites would naturally pick the species with the highest native intelligence. With the extra boost, this brainy animal quickly beats down its own enemies and puts itself in much the same position as man here on Earth. Lord of the beasts, divine right to run the place and all that. Now understand, it's the animal who's become intelligent, not the parasite. The parasites are operating on complex instinctive patterns, not unlike a hive of bees. Oh, they're wonderful neurological engineers, but it's pure blind instinct.
That's all wild guesswork, of course.
Well, there's some guesswork, but none of it's wild. You see, there's supporting evidence. They sent a message.
A message?
Sure. I'll show you. On second thought, perhaps you'd better show yourself. There's a meteorite on that shelf. Take it down. Oh, don't worry, it's sterile. Now tell me what you find.
Almost perfect gray metal sphere. Steel, maybe, but it's lighter in weight than I would expect. Hollow, 8-9 inches in diameter. Some scorching and pitting. From friction with the Earth's atmosphere, I suppose.
Yes. What else? Look closely by your thumb.
A line. That's where it's been cut open.
No. Using that as an equator, put a hand on each pole and twist.
My God. It twists apart. And there's another fitted inside.
And a third. Now take out the second shell, the hard, thin one between the softer protecting shells.
I don't see any message.
There's a small bottle of iron filings in that drawer by your knee. Sift some powder over the sphere. Carefully now.
Son of a gun. It looks like a globe. A map.
That's what we thought at first, too. And then we looked more closely using that finer dust. If you look at the lines through a good reading glass, you can just see that they're rows of symbols. Pictographs.
And you've made it out?
Some. Enough to guess what I've just told you. It would have been more, but most of the ones we had gotten had been treated rather rudely. Battered or taken to a machinist to cut open on a lathe. Our curiosity is rather ape-like.
What exactly do the patterns say, Doctor?
I've told you some of it. History, origins, and that. We pieced together the reasons for sending the spheres out, too. Their sun was about to go nova. They worked out a theoretical space drive, but couldn't fuel it adequately to save themselves, so they cultured up a batch of their parasite benefactors and fired them like charges of buckshot at various stars.
You mean they weren't aiming at the Earth in particular?
No. Just one of several blind shots. A last-ditch stand against extinction. Symbolic, to be sure, but a noble gesture as far as they were concerned. A giving away of part of their souls, like a man writing his will and leaving his last worldly possessions to some unknown species beyond the stars.
Doctor.
Imagine them standing there, watching the projectiles being fired out towards deep space. There goes their inheritance to an unknown heir. The little creatures that brought them up from beasthood. You can see them turn away
Hold
and
up.
Silently go back.
Yeah, there we go. I took it off.
To reach
yeah.
They've left their last
Hey, Miss Lative.
Hey,
Just working on comic book stuff.
This thing as desirable.
I didn't say it's desirable. I simply pointed out that the creatures who sent it saw it as desirable.
But maybe they just didn't care.
Of course they cared. Their error was expecting
There's big battle in here?
As they would have done. They never considered that a being could be both brash and intelligent. They meant for us to read the warning on the
Wow,
show.
Oh, two viewers.
Yes, warning.
I'm really
this
kicking it, aren't I?
Oversized symbols marks all the spheres.
Sorry, I turned it off. Emote only.
You who destroy your own. If you do this, then go no further. The contents will only help to destroy you.
Dr. Severs, what do you think will happen now? To the world, I mean.
I saw a baby born yesterday.
Gotta make it more dynamic. But thank you guys so much. I do appreciate you coming in saying hey.
Small pores.
Just tell me if it's too loud.
Also a nodule above each high, insensitive to infrared.
Or too low, I don't know.
If our grandchildren, if man's still on the earth by then, may perhaps taste analyzed substances by touch, or see a warm radio
yeah.
in a dark room.
I'm just being as cautious as I can be. I know that hate raids can come out of nowhere, so you gotta watch out.
But there's a hitch. If man intends to keep fighting with his fellows, the parasite will help him to do a better job of that, too. Well, son, you're illuminated now. What do you intend to do?
What can anyone do except run? Isolate myself from this insanity.
Intend
and
taking the condition
have
with
all
you.
All the bar goers.
Are you crazy?
Right here.
That's
I have a few of them because I'm not drawing all their fucking faces.
Father, these last 3 days here, I can't thank you enough. I wish there was something I could do in return.
There is one thing.
What's that?
Uh-oh.
The young lady's been asking.
It's always a favor for a favor, as they say.
She? Over the crisis, I think. Infection's down. Nervous condition not so good. Deep depression. We've got her up on crutches a bit. Seems to help her to get out of the room, but sometimes
But I fixed it, so it should be all good. Thank you for coming in, just chilling out.
Sometimes
I do appreciate it.
She touched you.
I'm only going to be streaming for about an hour and 15 minutes, so
that.
It'll be nice.
She's asleep now. When she's awake, she's dazed. Combined effects of pain, shock, infection, guilt, right? She thinks you're avoiding her.
It's the plague that
you
I'm avoiding, not her.
You're talking to me, aren't you?
It's rather late.
You know what? No, that's a good extreme angle.
Works down
It'll be
vessel.
Fine.
If the rain stops by dawn, there should be time to launch her.
I'll be glad to go.
Will you?
At any rate, I expect you'll be glad to have me out of here.
No, Paul.
Have everybody turned.
Can't say as we'll miss that shotgun.
Three tables.
Willie will miss you, too.
I can't stay, Father.
Well, I will leave you to your plans. Your candle's burning low. Would you like another?
No.
I hope everybody's day gets better and better.
Long day tomorrow.
Good night.
We just enjoy ourselves.
Good night, Father. And Father, thank you again. You, your people here, you've meant a great deal to me.
You're welcome, Paul. Good night.
It'll be okay, you know. Even though I have work, doesn't mean anything.
No, I can't stay.
The vessel is repaired.
How is she?
She is ready.
How is she?
She is ready.
My hand.
Look at your hand.
The glass. Look with the glass. bridges, sprouting neurons. Tiny farmers tending gray soil. No!
She is ready. Hear the ocean. Graceful craft. What will you call her? Willow. Pretty name.
Yeah, it's graceful, nothing but a chill day and stuff like that. I mean, nothing really big.
Willie.
Dearest.
Enjoyed my time.
Your skin is soft.
Woke up real nice, slept. I was gonna stream last night, but I just just went to bed.
Who's there? My gun! God damn! My gun! Who's there? Matches. Where are the matches?
Paul, I'm coming in.
What on earth? Safety, damn you. You guaranteed my safety. I had a prowler. I think I've been touched.
Dear Mother of God. Mother Superior, make an inspection of the sisters' quarters. If any of them...
Father, the injured girl. She's not in her bed. She's gone.
Willie.
Search the building for her.
What can I do to disinfect myself?
Someone please get Dr. Seavers.
I'm here. What's all the noise? What's going on?
Have you got any disinfectants?
Disinfectants? For what?
Father, the girl's not anywhere in the building.
My God. The ocean. I've got to
go. No, Paul. You're not going to.
Not me. Willie.
She's got to be hunched over. She's cold.
Willie, no. No, stay back from the surf. Really? Oh, thank God.
Paul, I did it, Paul. It was like a dream at first. But then you shouted and I just... But Paul, I...
Come here. Now, Willie. You wet, beautiful, sandy gray lady. Let me carry you back to that hospital. We've new senses to learn. Together. New world to explore. And first we've got to get you healed up. There's a boat waiting for us. You and me.
Our cast for this episode featured Bob Hess as Paul and Rosemary Roundtree as Willie. Father Mendelhaus was played by Jerry Haynes, and George Lochford was Dr. Seavers. Other voices were by David Roth and Gene Evans. The original story, Dark Benediction, was written by Walter M. Miller, Jr., and adapted for Sci-Fi Radio by Douglas R. Frazier. Our director was John O. Williams. All music and sound effects were created by Ron DiIulio. The series producers are Kevin Singer and Ron DiIulio. Support for this program has been provided by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. This is James Edward Kerr, inviting you to join us soon for our next venture into the imaginary worlds of sci-fi radio. Fear. It lurks within the human mind, waiting to take control. Fear. Both real and imagined, is at work within this story, a story written by Ursula K. Le Guin. Listen, as Sci-Fi Radio explores the various levels of fear in Diary of the Rose.
Dr. Nates recommends I keep this diary. Memory stored in memory, bits of thought stored within a microchip. Called up again, when necessary, through the miracle of audioscopy. Though why it should ever need to be called up again is beyond... Why is there so much fear? Why? No, just focus on the need, the purpose. But what is the purpose? Observations of the patient Flores Sorde? Or possible deviations from positive thinking? Dr. Nades says it's important to record these thoughts nightly, just as they occurred to me at work. It is spontaneity that is the most informative in self-examination. Her words. Her exact words, I remember them.
That's it, isn't it? That thing, that chair.
Good morning, Mr. Sorday. I'm Dr. Sobel.
I'm not sitting in that damn chair.
All right, if that's your wish. There's no need to attempt to examine the chair. It's much too complex to comprehend.
Not for an engineer.
Well, I don't understand it. To me, it's always looked like a dentist chair.
Just so it's not an electric chair.
Poor Flores. So distrustful. Of course, if the initial diagnosis of delusional paranoia is correct, then that would explain it. Yet, but who am I to diagnose his psychological state? An MD in psychoscopy. Leave all levels of psychological analysis to Dr. Nades. She called up my entry from yesterday. She was pleased. True and spontaneous thoughts, she had said. Not just technical data, spontaneous thoughts. Yes. Candor, all important, she had said. What a good little audioscopist I am. It's still there, isn't it?
I fail to see the humor in that statement.
No, I meant the fear, not the chair.
To me, they're one in the same.
Sit down, Mr. Sorty.
No.
I'm sorry. I meant over here by my desk.
Oh. If you wish. Is that the screen where you allegedly watch it all?
Well, it's the psychoscope screen, yes.
And that's all that chair is used for?
Yeah.
To allow you to look into our minds?
Well, it's a little more complex than that, but yes.
Not electroshock?
No, absolutely not.
Will you promise me that?
Of course. I'm a psychoscopist, Flores. May I call you Flores?
Whatever. Do you promise?
Yes. I never deal in electroconvulsive therapy. My work is diagnostic, not therapeutic.
They've already hurt me, you know. Cracked.
Yes. I'm sorry. They said you were violent when they brought you here.
Violent?
Well, perhaps you blocked it from your memory. It isn't uncommon.
I haven't forgotten a single thing, and by God, as long as I have an ounce of strength in me, none of you will make me forget anything. Ever.
Flores Sorday, initial psychoscopy, 30 May, 0900 hours. Attendants lead the patient towards the chair. He examines the metal crown. Curious. Highly intelligent. Can't wait to read his thoughts. Frightened. He's actually trembling. He insists on sitting in the chair unaided. The attendants strap his arms and legs. The crown is put in place. Such fear. Such uncommon fear. Sweating profusely, eyes forced shut, mouth drawn to a tight line, hands gripping the arms so tightly they are white to the wrists. The screen is almost white too. Instinctual elements overriding both the conscious and unconscious. It doesn't really hurt, does it?
I wouldn't know.
Well, does it? It's been on for 90 seconds.
I don't believe you.
Test me.
What do you see?
Oh.
Well?
It's such incredible detail.
That doesn't tell me much.
It's just that most people, you know, they don't think in such crisp images. Such vivid...
Tell me what you see.
A rose. The most beautiful... Oh, don't. Don't make it go away, please. Oh.
The color. What color was it?
Pink. A full-blown pink rose. Beautifully sensed and visualized. Clear and steady, whole... Incredible, really. Oh, there was music, the most beautiful.
That's all? Nothing
Well, the conscious mind can only image on one object at a time within its field of perception.
I meant, nothing else is going to happen.
Audioscopy, Flores. Nothing more. Just your conscious and unconscious perceptions emerging on this screen. Nothing more.
They're really none of your business, you know.
I'm merely trying to help.
But ethically, you have no right. No right at all.
Spent the PM analyzing Flores Soler's hollows. I have never seen any psychoscopic imaging, not even a drug-induced hallucination, so fine and vivid as that rose. The rose. His rose. So powerful, so very, very intriguing, compelling. The shadows of one petal on the other. The velvety, damp texture of the petals. The pink color, full of sunlight. The white central crown. No, stop. This is not what Dr. Nades would want. There is something wrong here. Something terribly wrong. Emotions I'm not allowed to feel. Nothing even life at its fullest should be experienced that vividly. Dr. Nades said... Flores? Flores? I've come to see you, Flores. Please acknowledge me. What do you see out that window? Are you ignoring me? I must talk to you. I've noted something disturbing on the hollow.
Why am I in this hospital?
Why, for diagnosis and therapy.
Diagnosis and therapy of what?
Well, perhaps, as I suggested earlier, perhaps you've repressed the episode, the violent behavior.
I've repressed nothing. I was waked up at 2 a.m, jailed, interrogated, beaten up and drugged. I suppose I did behave a little oddly during all that, wouldn't you?
Sometimes a person under stress misinterprets other people's actions.
Doctor, please, can you really not know why I'm here?
Listen to this, Dr. Nades.
Keep out.
Conscious resistance, a form of biofeedback, self-talk, mind clutter. A device used by those in the Secret Service to block attempts to probe their minds.
He was able to sustain it for a full 20-minute session. There was a concentration on his breathing, bodily rhythms, pain in his ribs, and visual input from the scope room.
A dangerous man. We suspected as much.
Yeah. Paranoia and intelligence can be a dangerous combination. But why did he fear my examining him?
Now remember, this is a sketch, guys. Just remember it's a sketch.
I'm crossing over some classified threshold here.
Perhaps you are.
Another thing. He seems to trust me. He asked me to promise that there would be no electroshock. Now that doesn't fit a paranoid pattern. You don't ask for promises from someone you can't trust.
Transference. Simple Freudian transference. He must trust someone.
Okay, thank you for coming in, Miss.
But beyond that, there's...
You're amazing. Stay positive. I believe in you. Show me some of your sketches.
My child is to be cautious.
Just remember, you know, nothing is that quick. Hell, look at how my sketches go. Believe in yourself because I already believe in you.
Flores, your breathing is monitored by the apparatus. I don't need to know that you're still breathing. It's boring.
I like to do my own monitoring, Doctor.
But the more you breathe, the less you think. I need your cooperation. I'm trying to find out what you're afraid of.
I know what I'm afraid of.
Why won't you tell me?
You never asked me.
That That's most unreasonable.
Isn't that silly? Being indignant with a mental patient because he's unreasonable?
Yes, I suppose it is.
Well, Rosa, you can laugh.
How did you know my first...
It's not a national secret, is it?
No, I just didn't realize that you were interested enough to...
An attendant, Rosa. An attendant told me.
Damn you! That's just another evasive device.
Not entirely.
Floris, what are you afraid of? Floris?
I'm afraid of electroshock. Of having my mind destroyed, being kept here, or only being let out when I can't remember anything.
All right. Why don't you concentrate on that while I'm watching the screen?
Why should I?
Why not? You've said it to me.
I trust you.
I just want to see the color of your thoughts.
It's none of your business, the color of my thoughts. What the hell are you doing? You're reading the very core of my being. Voyeur, damned voyeur, let me alone. Get out.
Here's your tea, Flores.
Thank you.
Are you still angry with me?
The garden is beautiful.
Yes. I remember my mother had a garden when I was a little girl. It was so peaceful. But that was before.
Yes.
I put two lumps of sugar in your tea.
You know I like sugar. I suppose your psychoscope told you I liked sugar.
Don't be silly. Everybody likes sugar if they can get it.
No, little doctor, they don't. How the hell old are you? Why aren't you married? Are you wedded to your work? Dedicated? Helping the mentally unsound back to a constructive life of service to the state?
Whenever you're through. I happen to like my work.
Huh.
I am new at it. It took me years to get my degrees, and I'm not going to give it up.
Oh.
I guess dedicated is an accurate word, just as you are to your work.
I was. Goodbye to all that.
Why?
All gone, right?
Why are you so convinced you're going to be prescribed electroshock? I haven't even diagnosed you yet.
Diagnosed me? Look, stop play-acting, please. My diagnosis was made by the learned doctors of the state. Severe case of disaffection. Prognosis, evil. Therapy, lock him up in a room full of screaming, thrashing wrecks, and then go through his mind the same way you did his papers, and then burn it. Burn it out. Right, Doctor? Why do you have to go through all this posing, diagnosis, tea in the garden? Can't you just get on with it? Do you have to paw through everything that I am before you burn it?
Lord, you're saying destroy me. Don't you hear yourself? The psychoscope destroys nothing. I'm not using it to gather evidence. It's not a court. You're not on trial. I'm not a judge. I'm a doctor. Do you know what I would like to see?
What?
Your childhood.
All right. You can have my childhood. Why not? You're going to get all of the rest anyhow. Listen. You take it all, don't you? Could I see a playback?
Would it help us in our relationship?
Yes, I believe it would.
Okay. Come look, I'll run back the tape. Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, put on your earphones.
What is all that? The running up and down scales motion in the background there?
A visual scan. Your eyes were closed, and subliminal proprioceptive input. The unconscious dimension and the body dimension overlap to a great extent all of the time.
You watched all of that at once?
I told you it took 8 years.
Maybe you aren't such a fool, Doctor. Maybe you're just absorbed in your work. That can be dangerous, you know, to be so absorbed in your work. But that kind of sincerity... I guess I can even cooperate.
Dr. Nades gave me this book to read, De Kalm's The Psychology of Politics. It is so hard to understand. So different from that of psychology as I understand it. Everything seems backwards. I must be genuinely attentive at PT sessions Sunday nights from now on. I have been lazy-minded. But the comms is so hard. Flores laughed when I mentioned the title. He said, "That's a good little citizen." Flores. I feel honored to share in his life, his being. Today he looked directly at me and he smiled so sweetly. And he showed me the rose.
Your audioscope tapes, Rosa. I haven't heard them.
Yes.
It's been a week?
Yes, I know.
Audioscope tapes are to be submitted for review weekly.
I know.
As a precautionary check against being overwhelmed by what the psychologist of the past called empathy. You have been completing your tapes.
Yes.
Well.
I'll bring them in. But you're an engineer. You could edit them.
I've never tampered with state-owned material in my life. Not one single edit.
But they don't belong to the state. They're my own thoughts.
Editing them. That would be a willful act of disaffection.
I know. Flores, please. They could be harmful to both of us. The feelings I revealed, they're prohibited.
I'll help. This one time, I will take action.
Your audioscopy tapes, they seem...
Yes?
They seem clearer. More lucid than normal. As if you're beginning to comprehend the doctrine of positive thinking.
I've read De Calms nightly, and, well... Perhaps I'm beginning to understand.
Yes, perhaps you are.
We'll have a good session today, Flores. Make lots of breakthroughs. Flores? What on earth? A bear. A huge, wonderful bear.
Okay. I created him when I was 5 or 6. Was big, I was small. He smashed down walls and destroyed things. Bad things, you know. Bullies. People who scared my mother.
Hey, Haven!
And then he
How are you?
With me riding on his
He's wonderful.
I haven't thought about him in 30 years. There was a time when I thought I had turned
attended the positive thinking session tonight and took notes. Dr. Kay spoke on the dangers of liberalism.
We have a guest for tea today, little doctor.
I'm Professor Arca.
Well, how do you do?
I'm Professor Arca. Professor
Yay!
Arca.
How was work? I'm about to head to work at 2.
Of course, that was a long time ago.
I'm Professor Arca.
Do you know how many electroshock treatments he has had? 60. But, doctor...
I'm Professor Arca. 60. 60 treatments.
He wrote The Idea of Liberty. Didn't you, Professor?
No. I'm Professor Arca.
I read his book when I was in engineering school. It existed then. On the bookshelves. It doesn't exist anymore.
Flores, please.
Not a single copy anywhere. Ask Professor Arca. He's never heard of it.
It was really good today. Finally got a new manager. Good, good. Bad managers, get out of here.
I have read the comms again.
Hope they're a good manager for you. Hope everything's good over there.
Psychological. How do I treat this kind of psychosis, a political psychosis? I see how FS should think and feel, and the difference between that and his present state of mind. But how do I educate him so he can think positively? Dr. Nades must focus on positive thinking. Dr. Nades would want that. DeCom says that the core of disaffection is a negative condition which must be filled with positive ideas. But this does not fit dear Flores. The gap is not in him. Flores? What do you find so interesting out that window? Oh.
Well, that's good. Flush. That's good.
In a single.
You hanging out with your kid?
So delicate and yet so sturdy.
Hello, my dear. Good, like Chimera. I'm a lurk for you, okay? And also, I want to let you know an announcement. There is an update due to something with me, myself, and I. So when you get a chance, look, and then if any question, let me know. It's all good, Ojibwa. Thank you for coming in.
On Professor Arca.
Thank you for being awesome.
Well, I thought it would help with Flores Sorde. Their cases seem similar.
Thank you for just saying hey.
Regarding Professor Arca is classified.
Flores file, then.
Flores?
Mr. Sorde's arrest file, then. I must know exactly how he behaved if I am
to
help.
Say
that information is classified. You are requesting classified information. You may not request classified information.
I asked once, why is there so much fear? Well, now I know. Why is there no privacy? It is unfair and sordid.
Gotta get that pizza.
Her office,
gotta get that pizza.
She does not. Only persons of authority can have secrets.
Dwarves.
Her secrets are all good, even when they are lies. Listen, Rosa Sobel, doctor of medicine, specialist in psychoscopy. Listen. Whose thoughts
Goblins.
Are you thinking, yours or his? Months inside his mind.
And then
mind.
Flags
thoughts,
all over. Over the country map and stuff like that.
Mind.
This is going to be a big-ass fucking picture.
Like you've only worked with the crippled and terrified. You never met an equal before. Who is the therapist, you or he? If there is nothing wrong with him, what am I supposed to cure? How can I help him? How can I save him? By teaching him to lie? Not at your window today?
Last night's frost.
Also, love you. Okay, take care and stay awesome. I will stay awesome.
I put in a request for co-analysis with a strong prognosis of complete cure if we work together. You have a brilliant mind. With co-analysis, we could...
Change it.
Alter some of your perceptions.
I'm afraid that would be impossible. Little doctor.
Whoa,
Dr. Sobel,
little.
Dr. Rosa Sobel, report to Dr. Nades at once. Dr. Rosa Sobel, report to Dr. Nades at once.
A ridiculous request. Coanalysis.
I'm sorry. I thought it would help.
I'm beginning to question your critical judgment, doctor.
I'm sorry. I'm terribly sorry. Last night, I dreamed I rode on a bear's back up a deep gorge between steep mountainsides. Slopes going steep up into the dark sky. Oh, it was winter. There was ice on the rocks. Tomorrow morning, I will tell Nades I am resigning and requesting a transfer to Children's Hospital. But she must approve the transfer. If not, I'm out in the cold. I'm in the cold already. Door locked to record this. There's no place anymore. No single place.
Doctor? Dr. Sobel?
You in there? Your patient, Sorte, requests permission to see you.
We met in the hall. He was looking orderly. I took his hand. It was big and bony and very cold.
Is it now, Rosa? The electroshock?
No, no. Just some more tests. EEG, probably.
Then I'll see you tomorrow.
Yes. Yes, of course. Hello, Flores.
Hello. I'm sorry, do I?
I'm Dr. Sobel, Flores. I'm Rosa.
I'm pleased to meet you, Doctor.
I am Rosa. I am the rose. The rose. I am the rose. The rose with no flower. The rose all thorns, the mind he made, the hand he touched, the last rose of winter.
Jesus. Depressing. Just depressing.
Our cast featured Nancy Grotning as Rosa, Charles Carroll as Flores, and Gloria Hocking as Dr. Nade. The original story, Diary of the Rose, was written by Ursula K. Le Guin and adapted and directed for Sci-Fi Radio by your host. All music and sound effects were created by Ron DiIulio. The series producers are Kevin Singer and Ron DiIulio. Support for this program has been provided by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. This is James Edward Kerr, inviting you to join me soon for our next venture into the imaginary worlds of Sci-Fi Radio.
Dr. Shapir, three of them, two damn good astronauts and a PhD. We don't know. That's why we called you. The Psyche 14 mission. Yes, hell yes, 13 flawless missions, and then this. NASA, hell, Washington's up in arms over this one. No, no, there's nothing medically wrong with them. That's the problem. What we have is one dead man who just willed it. Another blind who isn't blind, and a third who hears God only knows what. Yeah, as soon as you can get it. They saw, they experienced something up there, and we've got to find out what the hell it is, or this whole project's going to be strained.
Please, can you see anything?
Yes, please, let me have the blindfold.
Do you see this light, Professor Hughes? What color is it?
All colors, white. It's too bright.
Will you point toward it, please?
It's everywhere. It's too bright.
The room is quite dark, Professor. Now, will you open your eyes again, please?
It isn't dark.
Possible supersensitivity here. Now, Professor, let's
look,
try.
You can drop the Professor crap, right? I'm just Hughes now, if I'm even that.
Very well. Hughes, then. Just Hughes.
And you? You're the shrink they sent for?
Psychiatrist, yes. I'm Dr. Shapir. Is this dark enough for you?
Make it dark. No, look, let no,
your
no,
hands
no,
down.
No,
take it easy. All right, all right. We'll put the compresses back on.
I'm sorry.
We'll try again later on when you rest it.
An experience. Not just an event, mind you. An experience on Mars that sees the consciousness of three space travelers, willing one to die, and forever changing the perception of the other two. Sci-Fi Radio presents an adaptation of Ursula Le Guin's The Field of Vision.
So what are your preliminary findings, Doctor?
One man who's afraid of the light, another whose auditory senses have left him almost catatonic. They both experienced something on that planet. Something that overpowered their senses. One's being drawn into it, the other's afraid of it. I need more information, Colonel Bowen, and their backgrounds, some concrete information on what happened up there.
Well, Hughes entered the space program from astrophysics, Harvard. Had a good record, some say brilliant. Too brilliant for me. You know,
hold up.
Doctor Shapiro,
hold up.
Tower intellectuals.
You don't care
for this kind of
potential for instability, Colonel?
An egghead, NASA's pull-up. And he isn't exactly stable at the moment, is he?
No. No, Colonel Bowen, he isn't.
He's the one who discovered the room. Had to unseal it. Damn intellectuals and curiosity. No military man would go snooping around unless he was ordered to.
You blame Hughes for Captain Temsky's condition?
Hell yes. And Commander Rogers' death, too. Don't forget that.
There's nothing we can do about Commander Rogers. But Captain Temsky...
Listen here. Now, Temsky was a crack test pilot. Nerves of steel. An Air Force captain.
There was no indication of his...
winding up like this? Hell no, there wasn't. He was all military, Doctor. Even coached a little league. Now, I don't know. He's crazier than you.
I don't think it's a matter of mental illness. It's...
Well, what the hell do you call it then, Doctor, when a man sits on a stool all day, staring and listening to something inside his head? A man who doesn't even know his own wife hums some kind of a classical tune or the other when she tries to talk to him. Now, Temsky hated that. Sent her out of the room in tears. Let me tell you this, Susan is one tough woman.
You're saying that beyond the hysterical deafness, the man has somehow changed. He's different now.
Like day and night.
Something changed his perception then.
Hughes drove him crazy.
Captain? Captain Temsky? You can hear me, can't you? Well, my voice is disturbing you, isn't it? It's interfering with something you would prefer to hear. I thought so. Stop humming again if you can understand what I'm saying.
Hell are we, Dr. Shapir?
What if I were to offer you absolute darkness?
What do you mean?
Total and complete darkness. A chamber devoid of light. We're in such a room now. We could remove the compresses and you'd be safe to talk to tell me what happened.
Total darkness?
A special chamber devoid of light.
It's just the light, you know? Just the light, nothing more.
Remove the compresses.
Yes. Oh God! Oh my God! The room, Rogers. Rogers, you see it, don't you? It's in here. With
there
us.
We go.
Hold on, Rogers. Stop screaming
there we
like
go.
That. Where's Temsky?
Forgot to put on my headphones.
Is that you?
Don, you.
I can't see you for life. Help me! It's Rogers. He's screaming in sort of bursts, like barking. Whole sentences at once. Temsky, you can hear it, can't you? You can hear him barking. Oh, God, it's like a seizure. I've got to pull him out of here. Like all his fuses blew, burned him out.
Where is he? I can't see light. Try to see what I touch and can't. I don't understand.
Hang on, Hughes. Hughes, I'm right here. Take it easy, sir. It's only the darkness. Only the darkness.
Oh, God.
Psychiatric counseling session, 18 July, Dr. Shapir, and patient 2131, Dr. Gerent Hughes.
Hello, Hughes. Listen, that wasn't such a bright idea of mine. The chamber. I'm sorry. I had no idea. No right.
Man, also, he says...
No. All right, I need a little company, too. Someone to talk to. You seem to be pretty calm.
As long as I keep my eyes closed.
Listen, I have a queer story about Joe Temsky. Not a story, just a queer fact, actually. Did you know that they've written on his record that he's functionally deaf?
Deaf?
Yes, deaf. Well,
just to show how large and in charge she is,
I go in and talk to Temsky.
To make it
touch him
a little bit
bigger.
I try
to make contact, any kind of contact to get through. No go. You know, I've got a theory.
What theory?
Suppose, maybe, but just maybe, Hughes can't hear me. Suppose his hearing is flooded with the sounds of his experience. Something like your sight being blinded by what took place in that room.
You mean he's hearing things?
Yes.
Listening?
Yes.
You can't shut your ears.
That's what I thought, too. Could be rough, couldn't it? Well, what I thought was, what about trying to shut them for him? Put earplugs in his ears.
Then he wouldn't be able to
just
hear
to
you.
Show how tall they
but he
are.
Wouldn't be distracted. If you had to watch your light show all of the time, you wouldn't be able to pay much attention to me or anything else, right? Maybe it's like that for Joe. Maybe there's this noise drowning out everything for him.
It would be more than noise.
I don't suppose you'd like to talk about what happened there in that room. No. All right.
Notes on Joe Temsky. Subject, earplugs. Observation date, July 20th at 0700 hours. Temsky's a heavy sleeper. Easy to insert ordinary wax plugs in his ears while he slept. When he awakened, he sat up, stretched, scratched, and looked for what appeared to be something to eat. Then he began to grow uncomfortable. At least he appeared to be uncomfortable. Maybe disoriented. Then he looked around, left, right, nervous. Maybe the jerky head movements were an attempt to find that vanished sound, the lost chord. More disturbed and alert, his hands groped for his ears to find the cause of the silence. He found the earplugs and removed one. Then he sighed deeply and seemed to slip back into the sound within.
Good, Temsky. That's an hour with the plugs in. I know you can't hear me, but I'm proud of you. And we've come up with a drug that will deaden your auditory nerve endings for 5 hours at a time. It will be ready next week. Now let me take these plugs out.
Dr. Thompson, report to emergency.
September 3rd, notes on Joe Temsky. Subject, auditory nerve experiments, 1400 hours. Patient responds to drugs quite well. Somehow seems relieved, yet grows anxious at times, as if wanting to go back, to turn his interest inward again. Patient asks to see Hughes.
Well,
How about it, Doctor? We're making progress. I got the press, NASA, Washington all over me.
I'm sensitive to that, Colonel, but we're still probing for answers.
Well, I'm not sensitive. Now, you fix Timsky, you hear me? You fix him, and I want him flying again. You can be sensitive with that other guy.
How are you feeling, Hughes? Hughes? I guess a little withdrawn today. You feel like just listening? Temsky wants to see you. The new drug's working. It's blocking out those sounds of his. But he has some questions about what really happened. You could help him a great deal if you would.
Well, how do I communicate with him? Sign language?
He can talk to you while you respond on the word processor. Would that be agreeable to you? Hughes, he needs assurance that something really happened in that room you found. That it wasn't all in his head.
Oh, something happened up there, all right. Hughes? Oh, man, it's good to see you. Let me read this. Yeah, it was a poor choice of words. I'm sorry, Hughes. I wish you could see, too. Well, it's working. I mean, the drug makes the sound stop. But I'm worried, Hughes. Did something real happen to us up there? Or was it all in my... Yeah, you're right.
Human.
I mean, if all this was just inside my head, the earplugs would actually help improve the reception. Then you're saying something did happen inside that room. God, Hughes, what was it?
Hughes. Oh, yeah, it's coming together. It's coming together. It's coming together.
What am I saying?
I wish I had.
I
wish I could.
See, when they first
put these in files.
Ears, when I woke up,
I mean, I can put it in a list.
But I was really.
I don't like putting it in a list. It
took me a long time to come back from where I'd been, and I didn't much want to come back. That I was suffering from hallucinations, or maybe I was. Crazy. I don't know.
When also save.
Began telling me how
remember
long
to save.
Been, I realized that this was Earth. You know, that's what spooked me.
But I hope
maybe
everybody's day is only getting better and brighter.
It scared me.
Unless
like,
it's late at night, so
people.
You know.
But I began to put it together to see that it wasn't a split, but a. Yeah, exactly. A change. It changed me. God. It is real. I mean, because when I can hear, that's all I can hear. And when you can see, that's all you can see, right? Wow, we have to be artificially blinded and made deaf not to hear it and see it. That's it, isn't it? Oh, no. Mm-mm. Beautiful. It took me a long time. At least I thought it was a long time to begin to get it. At first, it didn't make any sense. Jesus, it scared the hell out of me. You or Commander Rogers would say something and, I don't know, there'd be these kinds of chords all around your voice, like rainbows around a prism, so you can't even see the prism. Like, well, that's what it's like for you, isn't it? Well, it's the same, only with this hearing, it's like everything turns into music. I'll tell you what, though. What I'd like to do while I'm out of touch is get it all down somehow. Huh. One of the things I've learned is the only way to cope with this thing is to surrender to it. Then it seems to come into perspective. Has it been like that for you? Afraid?
spend the last few minutes in here, darling.
Look at me, Joe. I'll speak slowly so you can read my lips. This is the day room. I wanted some time alone with you.
I've never been in here. Somehow I feel drawn to it. Where's the piano?
Joe, watch my lips. I thought you said you'd never been in here before.
I haven't. Yet I just know there is one. There it is. Come on, I want you to play for me.
Joe, what's gotten into you? You couldn't hear the music any more than you can... Joe, please, look at me. You've never liked to hear me play, especially the music I've been trained to play.
A man can change, can't he? Come on, sit down. I'll sit next to you.
What would you have me play, kind sir?
Something beautiful.
Moonlight Sonata.
If you could hear it, you might like
you
it.
Son of a bitch, I love Moonlight Sonata.
Sound like this.
Moonlight Sonata is one of my most favorite of piano pieces. It's because it is a piano piece. That's what I love about it, because there's a lot of piano pieces that I feel that if you just added more instruments can really, like, make it sound way better, where Moonlight Sonata is good on its own. If you added no instruments, Moonlight Sonata is one of the only pieces I feel that can stand on its own. Now, there's some more beautiful pieces, but I'd rather them add a little bit of instruments in the background. And then there's Flight of the Bumblebee, but you can play that on trumpet or a saxophone, and it has a better sound. Like on piano, it sounds good, but then when you add the saxophone and the trumpet to it, I can't fucking do it. It's so fast. It's so fucking fast.
I understand that now.
Yeah.
The understanding comes when one surrenders.
I don't know if you play the piano or anything like that.
Recreate it for others to hear. That's when.
What's your favorite piano piece?
But what is it?
Whatever it is, it's in the room with us. And it's in the music. And I want to share it.
Working in the dark, Hughes?
That's not exactly funny, Joe. If you could hear me, I'd tell you.
But I can hear you.
Impossible. I have a musical bone in my body. Oh, no. Oh, no. It's okay, Haven.
What?
It's all right. I won't judge you harshly for it. I probably don't have that. Actually, I tried to say that I don't have any musical talent. I'm literally making a comic with a fucking bard. No musical talent.
Besides these damned images, I can get a concrete handle on what we experienced up
here. The polos were blank. You can't can't photograph what we saw, what we experienced. Jesus, Hughes, take off your blinders.
No.
You can't stay inside yourself forever. Come out. You can't choose blindness, Hughes.
Well, why can't I?
Not after you've seen the light.
What light?
The light, the word, the truth we've been taught to perceive and to know.
Get out. Get out, Kinski.
Chatter.
Good. Put it on audio response.
It was determined that there should be another mission, a Psyche 15, to re-examine, to re-evaluate the site, the room, and then to reseal it for all time.
I think you're overdoing it, Hughes.
It has to be here. The answer.
They're sending me back to New York. I asked for another 2 weeks with you here, but no go.
It's all right.
Somehow I failed. I tried, but I
don't know. It wasn't you. You couldn't have. Oh, never mind.
But
nothing matters.
But your experiments.
An illusion. Just as any answers you would have found.
No.
Oh, you think not? Look, Doctor. Look. I'm removing these silly blinders. Look. Hide and seek. I spy. You're it. You want to know what I see?
Yes.
A blot. A shadow. An incompleteness. A rudiment. An obstruction. Something completely unimportant. You see, it doesn't do any good to be a man,
and
even...
And when you look at yourself?
Well, the same, just the same. A hindrance, a triviality, a blot on the field of vision.
What is the field of vision?
What do you think? What is a true vision of? Reality, of course. I have been reprogrammed to perceive reality, to see truth. I see God.
Those were Kinski's words, too. At his last lecture and performance. Only he heard God.
Well, for me, seeing is believing. And I'll be damned if I'll become a missionary like Kinski.
A missionary?
Can't you see, Doctor? Can't you see that's what the room is? A training center, a briefing room. It's a
religious center, a church?
A place where you're taught to see God and hear God and know God and love God. A conversion center, a place where you're converted, where your mission becomes the mission. We learned the mission. We came out with the mission. We weren't explorers anymore. We were missionaries, bearing the truth, charged with bringing it to the other races. All the poor damn heathens living in outer darkness. We are the bearers of the truth, the answer. Nothing else matters. The earth doesn't matter. The stars don't matter. Death doesn't matter.
This is some,
nothing is
this
anything.
Is some fucking heavy
God
shit. Sci-fi,
God.
Old
not
sci-fi
God.
Shit is legit.
God, the one true God.
Like, there's
Eminent
some hokey shit in all of it.
Forever.
But then there's
I
this. And
God.
This just kind of
all
fucking gets real deep
now,
real
I see
quick.
The face of God. And I'd give all my life to see a tree.
This feels just like Big O or something like that.
Chair. Wooden chair. Ordinary. They can keep their God. They can keep their light. I want the world back. I want questions, not the answer. I want my own life back and my own death.
On the recommendation of the Army psychiatrist who took over the case of Gerent Hughes after Shapir was dismissed, Hughes was moved to a military hospital for the insane, where, unfortunately, he carried out a successful suicide attempt, slashing his wrist with a spoon handle which he had sharpened by rubbing it against the bed frame. It is an interesting fact that he killed himself on the very day the Psyche 15 mission returned from Mars, bringing the documents and records which, as interpreted by the first apostle, now form the first chapters of the revelation of the ancients, the sacred text of the holy and universal Church of God, bringer of light to the heathen, sole vehicle of the one eternal truth.
Our cast featured Wirt Kane as Colonel Bowen and Howard Fisher as Dr. Shapir. Astronauts Hughes and Tempsky were played by Rick Spiegel and Greg Loso. Susan was portrayed by Nance Williamson. The original story, The Field of Vision, was written by Ursula K. Le Guin and adapted and directed for Sci-Fi Radio by your host. All music and sound effects were created by Ron DiIulio. The series producers are Kevin Singer and Ron DiIulio. Support for this program has been provided by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. This is James Edward Kerr, inviting you to join me soon for our next venture into the imaginary worlds of sci-fi radio.
I am cold. Someone, I cannot see them clearly, keeps feeding me. Oh, the taste is bad. I hear a child crying. Somehow I know the sound is me. I was born tonight.
See how he eats. He will grow fast and be strong, like you.
He eats as we all do. And he will live his life and die of old age in 8 short days like the rest of us. Better I kill him and be done with it.
That is my father. I can see him now, crouching against the low cave wall. He looks so old. There are other old people here in the cave, and they're dying. As I watch, they wither and die like wax melting before a flame.
Yes, I will kill him. No, let me kill him. Why? What does he have to live for?
No, no. He must live. There may be a future for him. He may live longer than us and be young.
Feed the child. It is almost dawn. Feed him. Make him grow. His life will be over soon enough.
My father wanted to kill me. To save me from growing old and dying, as he must, in a lifespan of only 8 days. But how could I know that? I'm less than an hour old. This is impossible, and yet, it's happening. What world is this?
What world indeed, where a complete lifespan is but 8 short days, an unbearable planet next to the sun of this small system. This is, as Sim's genetic memory would soon inform him, a planet with nights of burning cold and days like torches of fire. Only in the brief hour of dawn and again at sunset is the air breath sweet and flowers strong. Only then can the cave peoples bring their children out into a stony, barren valley to gather food. Only then in those 2 hours can the planet's life burst forth. Plants grow instantly, birds fling like pellets across the sky, smaller, legged animal life rush frantically through the rocks. In a matter of hours after his birth, Sim would know this, and know he would live his entire life in the caves with only 2 hours a day outside. Here, In the stone channels of air, he would eat and talk incessantly with his people, talk and think, but never sleep. And he would live exactly 8 days. Join us in one of the caves of this distant planet as Sci-Fi Radio presents an adaptation of the Ray Bradbury short story, Frost and Fire.
She will not let him kill you.
Who are you?
I am your sister, Dark. I am a full day older than you, Sim. But I do not use words yet. I speak to your mind.
Is it true? That we live only 8 days? How can that be?
Search your memory. Think and try to remember. In those moments before we were born, we had dreams of long lives, valleys of green, not stone, and then something shiny.
Yes. I seem to remember something silver, like a metal seed. Silver seeds crashing down. I see men and women tumbling onto this planet from them, scrambling to escape the radiation, hiding in the cliffs and caves. But how did we get here? From where did we come from?
You will learn, little brother. It was long ago, 10,000 days. Those who survived mutated. Their pulses quickened, reaching 1,000 beats a minute. The skin became tough, and their blood changed. We must eat constantly just to stay alive, to feed our altered systems. Like all life on this planet, the men and women lived and died in a week. Then we will do the same.
Is there no escape?
No escape. And yet, the scientists still work.
What scientists? Where? What do they do?
Dawn's coming. Bring the girl. Mountains stretch, straining to meet the new day.
Wait, be careful.
Woman, do not deny me the one excitement of a too short life. The night froze the mountains, silent and still as death. But now the sun makes them live again. I live in the challenge of the avalanche. Here comes another world. We'll move the rocks.
Will be beaten down by them. Now! We made it! By the gods! Made it alive!
Oh, you must have killed Timber.
I made it. Come along. The pool is melted now, and we can drink. Fill the skins to last the day, even if for the last time. Here, you take the boy and feed him while the girl and I gather some fruit.
Feed the boy.
Heaven, you must have
feed the boy. Haven, feed the boy.
Remember? Was it only 3 days ago? I can't believe. It's so unfair. Now I cry. An hour ago it was you.
An hour is half a life.
Come, take my hand. Let us look at everything.
I'm feeding him. My folks are always on me to groom myself and wear underpants. What am I, the Pope?
Just one more moment.
Feed the boy.
Let it catch me then.
You don't mean that.
Nothing at all.
Dark, bring the food and come quickly. The sun. Hurry. We must get back to the caves.
What are you looking for?
Something. Nothing. I don't know. I want to see a metal seed.
Okay, then.
Do not think about that now.
Yes, Dark.
You must use this day to touch and search the mind.
I'm very confused by this story, but I'm down for it.
Have them for only a few short hours more tonight.
Hey, Ben, are you paying attention? I'm just trying to figure out where this story is going. Because I'm very confused at this point. Now that feels like some 90s Goosebumps fucking...
I want to see the outside world once more. Just once more.
I cannot rise. I cannot...
Yeah, it's goofy.
Doll,
here I am, Mother.
Takes him.
Good.
Hold him. Feed him. He must eat. You both must eat.
Good. Thank God I'm not the only one. I'm very fucking confused. We've been paying attention this whole time. What the fuck is happening in this story?
Pick foods enough for the night to come. Eat. Play.
Oh my God. Yeah. I'm just...
Careful with it. Why? The child spoke.
Check me out on Instagram if you want to. If you want to check me out on Instagram. Thanks, everybody, for chilling out with me.
It was the last time Sim and Dark would see their parents alive. In the morning, their bodies were taken along with those of the others who had died during the night. In a long
I thought it was just me as I missed a bit at the start. No, like, I'm fucking confused as shit, and I've been paying attention the whole goddamn time.
Searing and charring the withered flesh, reducing the bones to fine powder. Dark walked in the procession, holding Sim by the hand. He had learned to walk just before dawn.
Okay.
After the funeral words were spoken, Sim and his sister ran among the broken rocks, feeding and chatting together. He was in his second day, she in her third.
Dark, I saw it from the top of the hill. A shining metal seed on a distant mountain. One of those that brought our ancestors to this place. And it wasn't shattered.
We hold hands together in confusion.
It doesn't look that far away.
What's going on?
Why would anyone try to get to it? Why can't we start right at sunset and then...
It's too far. Farther than it looks. And besides, no one knows how to make it work.
What about the scientists? Don't they know? We remember so much. Why can't we all think together? Doc, where are those men going?
They go to make war on the people who live in those small black cliffs.
But why, Dark? Why war? Life is so short as it is.
I don't know. It just happens. Eat. We must return to the cave soon.
Ah! The little one's been gathering fruit for me. I'll take that.
No, give it to me.
Mine. Give it to
Stop
me.
Stop it. Get on your way. Who are you? What's your name, bad one?
Kion. Kion. And tomorrow, little one, I will be big enough to kill you.
This life is short, little Sim. We make friends and enemies quickly. You must fight to protect yourself.
Oh, they're day people. Oh, okay. Oh, so their lifespan is quickened by days.
You were watching that little girl.
Hey, what's your name?
Light.
I'm Sim.
Sim, yes, I'll remember.
Here, eat. Eat or you'll never get big enough to catch her.
I see your life before you, little Sim. You'll need weapons soon to fight for this one called Light.
What the fuck is happening? I got... Okay, no, I think I'm getting it. It's literally people living a day. It's literally people living, like, Not that long. Okay, okay. No, I get the story. I'm getting it.
No one's ever been beyond it. All who tried to reach the plain were either frozen to death or burnt. All the land we know is a half hour out and a half hour back to the safety of the caves.
So she's asking for food.
Close to the entrance. We must go deeper where the rocks are still warm from the day.
No one has ever reached the middle since then?
The scientists. They try. Silly fools. They don't know enough to stop. It's no use. It's too far.
Dark. Tell me.
That makes a bit more sense. Yeah.
I wouldn't tell you if I knew.
I figured it out.
They kill you experimenting. You die with them while they struggle for nothing.
But Dark.
I don't want you joining them. Live your life. Don't cut it in half trying to reach that silly metal thing on the mountain.
Well, I'll find out where they are from someone else then.
No one else will tell you. They hate the scientists. And if you find them, what will you do? Save us? Save us, little boy?
I have to try. Try to find them. Try to reach the sea.
Go find them. They'll help you forget. Yes, forget your life's over in just a few more days. It's
their fault we're here on this world. It's their fault. Sim, it's me, Light.
Oh,
why were you running?
Light, I was looking
for the central chamber.
Oh no, I.
It is the night of learning. We must go to the chamber and listen to the words of the elders.
Light, you don't understand. We have so little time. I must
come. Sit with me. We can listen.
So she's explaining.
Here, take my hand.
Madam, I do apologize.
It's not fair. I can't waste a minute, much less a night.
There was another time in another place. Listen and learn of it. Learn of long days and tall grass that does not wither in the sunlight, Sim. See the blue sky at day and feel the warm nights under a canopy of bright stars. Remember lives that are measured in years, not days. Remember how it was before.
I see people strolling gentle hills. They do not rush.
Yes.
They are not eating all the time. Or talking all the time. Is this a dream?
In a way. Our minds.
So she's explaining, like there's not a lot of food on the mountain right now. There's some grain shortages. So I'm gonna put some images of grain and whatnot.
Makes us work. Try to find a way back.
Of not many carriages are coming up with food and whatnot.
The scientists.
What?
I was saying, young Sim, that the scientists crashed us on this world and now have wasted thousands of lives and time. It's no use. It's no use. Tolerate them, but give them none of your time. Remember, you live but once, and it's so short.
I cannot stay here any longer.
Sim, where are you going?
Don't tell me we have a recruit. I don't believe it. Chase him away. He's probably one of the warmongers. No. Come in, my boy. Now tell me, what do you want? I want to live. Are you a new breed? Are you sick? Why aren't you playing? Why aren't you readying yourself for the time of love and marriage and children? Don't you know that tomorrow night you'll be almost grown? That if you're not careful, you'll miss all of life. Shouldn't I be here? Certainly. We've had no volunteers from the rank and file for over 1,000 days. We've
for 1,000 days. Wow.
A closed unit. Count us. Six men and three Are we not overwhelming?
No, sir.
I mean, yes, sir. We ask for volunteers. And the people shout back at us, get someone else! Or, we have no time! And you know why they say that? Because they're selfish. They'd like to live longer, yes. But they know that nothing they can do can possibly give them more time. They won't give up their love, their brief youth, not one interval of a sunrise or sunset. Not even for the sake of their future offspring.
I understand.
You do? Well, if you do, you're rare. It's too much to expect anyone to understand anymore. My name is Dank. Tomorrow night, court here will be in my place. I'll be dead by then. And the night after that, someone else will be in court's place. And then you, if you work and believe. But first, I'll give you a chance. Return now to your playmates. Is there someone you love? Return to her. Life is short.
It's literally fucking short.
For the unborn. You have a right to youth, however brief. Go now, if you want. Because if you stay, you'll have no time for anything but working and growing old and dying at your work. But it is good work. Well, I will stay.
It was during Sim's third night of life that he found the scientist. He worked hard to understand the many things they had to teach. On through his third day and into his fourth night, he listened. He heard of the original seeds, the ships that crashed, and how the survivors hid and dug into the cliffs, grew old swiftly, and, in their scrambling to barely survive, forgot all science. He heard, too, of the attempts to reach the one remaining ship, how all had failed, lost to the burning sun or freezing night.
This sounds Sim like some video game music if there ever was one.
Try to reach the shining hull, his only chance
this
for
sounds
life.
Like goddamn,
On the morning of Sim's fourth day,
what is it?
Light found him.
Chrono Trigger?
There are three extra days for those of us who go to fight. Three extra days of life? If we win, we'd live 11 days instead of 8. Something about those cliffs protects you from the radiation.
If you live to enjoy them, if you're not killed in battle, if...
Oh, Chrono Trigger? Oh, I'd love to play it for stream. Once I get the computer running... I'm gonna test out the computer tonight, but
there are more of us now. We have
no, I'd love to play it for you guys. Chrono Trigger is so good. Chrono Trigger is one of the best games ever. It's one of the best RPGs ever.
With 3 extra days to try and reach it. That seems the only thing for me to do.
It is the only thing. I believe you. Go along now, Sim.
Goodbye.
Yeah.
That's right.
I'm gonna give you guys till 1:20, and then I gotta go though.
Goodbye then.
Because I gotta go to work. I'll give you till 1:20, okay?
War. To live 3 extra days. Why not?
So that's.
If we win.
Yeah, it's a very weird RPG. You could literally emulate it right now.
No,
I think you could. It would be a great game for you to emulate.
I will help you get to the ship.
Yes, if we win the battle. All right, it's just dawn.
So she's saying that you can't buy unless you work here and stuff like that.
I wonder if we're wasting it.
We're nearly there. Look ahead. See only what is to come. Look ahead here. You must eat.
No. No, I'm not hungry.
Eat. Keep your mouth full so you will be strong for battle.
Yeah.
It begins.
As the people snicker behind her.
I'm dead.
No, no. Just her, just her.
Stop!
Cyan, lie still.
Stop! Retreat! No.
Our people are leaving, running back.
I'll probably send you to Alexander then.
The sun is coming. Our time is almost up.
Cyan is coming. Can you walk?
I think so.
Walk, then. Slowly now, and faster. We'll make it. I know we will.
Get out of my way, Light. Let me have a look at our war. My leg!
My leg!
You'll never make it now. We'll have to leave him. Come with me, Light.
No.
He'll be dead in a few minutes. Come.
I go whenever you send me.
Carry me.
Them. All right. That's okay. Interjoe, how are you? I'm just working on comic book stuff, trying to get it done.
Can you walk?
Just, Elma... I gotta just put in big red letters. What am I?
We'll walk.
I just need to write down their names so I don't forget who's in what scene.
We came here to seek a home.
Oh, what am I working on?
I would rather die.
Just comic book stuff. Just getting this stuff done.
How much time do we have left? Before the sun.
So far
only
I've gotten. I reworked this one. So that there's a little bit more emotion in it, and it flows a lot faster. Because the thing is that I can't be so slow. I want people to be interested and get everything in, but I can't be too slow about the scene as a whole. And also not to completely redo. Alright. Everybody's amazing and they know it. Chat, you're incredible and you're awesome and you're stupendous. You work hard every day. Guys, I see you guys working so freaking hard and you step it up every time that I see it. It's so cool. Yeah, you all are so cool, and you guys are so sweet to me. You guys are all so sweet and awesome.
I'll learn as we go.
So they're snickering in the background. Snicker. Yeah, wholesome. Yeah, well, inner joke, hold up.
We do not touch each other, see?
Right now, so far, you got this one.
Yikes. The sun will do either of us in.
time, my name is Notch.
No! Megan!
Sam, hurry! Your son!
My leg! Aw, thank you. But you guys have been incredible and amazing. Oh, yeah, I think you got the gifted sub yesterday. Yeah, I did. I did.
I must sleep now. No, I cannot. I must live.
That's right.
To reach the ship.
Yeah, Glee. Explanation of, like, there's not enough food and all that, so. I am dumb. Screams to the heavens.
I can fight no longer.
Yeah, this panel is almost done. I don't even think I need to finish much of it. I just need to finish the details. I love just the glow. It's so good. The glow just kind of hits it correctly. And that's kind of all I need. I don't even need to show all the colors for it. I could obviously, you know, clean up the colors and stuff like that. But I think it's good the way it is. I love that it's kind of this.
What time?
Yeah.
The same day as the contest.
Oh, yeah.
Now be quiet.
Now, I think all of the panels are real good, but I think that one just hits you in the right way.
Nothing of your life. This is not.
And I'll put it as my YouTube panel and whatnot. And then I got one more panel to do. And then I forgot that I need to do an information panel. But I don't know what to put as information. So I'm like, what? What would I put down? Oh my goodness.
I won.
Notch is dead. So were we almost.
But yeah, no, I got. Let's see.
They honor you for defeating their greatest warrior.
We have no time to waste. My leg. Kion
has fled, Sam. Your leg is already healing.
Yeah, so I just need to finish this in a second. But yes, other than that, let me save. Remember to save. Never forget to save.
Our pulse, heartbeat, everything is a little slower now. I can feel it. We have more time now.
I must try my leg.
My leg!
I must!
My leg!
Stiff and sore.
Taking it easy. Take care, Ojima. Like what tablet and programs you use, probably? Yeah, I could.